Welcome to Ring of Fire. I'm Farron Cousins, and here's what's happening tonight. The diabetes medication Invokana has been linked to potentially fatal side effects. So we'll tell you everything you need to know about this widely used pharmaceutical. And we're taking your questions from Twitter. If you have a question, send it to us using the hashtag AskROF. And that's what's coming up tonight. You've just stepped in to the Ring of Fire.
How stupid are the people of the country?
And maybe I'll be a little bit unpresidential.
Congress declares war, not the president. Start with the countries that are burning our flag.
We regret these errors and apologize. We apologize.
We apologize.
And apologize.
This is good news, people.
We're going to start out tonight with some viewer questions. If you have a question that you want us to answer, send it using the hashtag AskROF. Our first question tonight comes from Keith Crows, who asks, why didn't the Sanders campaign more vigorously pursue charges of election fraud all around the country? Well, I think Bernie Sanders himself kind of spelled that out this past week when he said that Hillary Clinton won the election, the primary election, fair and square. That's what he said. Obviously, it's a little bit more technical than that. There were instances of voting machines flipping votes. There were plenty of people who were disenfranchised and not allowed to vote. So when you count those things in, just like with the presidential elections, it's not really fair. The question is it enough or was it enough to actually flip the election? And this is where I know a lot of the Bernie Sanders supporters disagree with me, but Hillary Clinton did win by over 3 million votes. Being able to steal 3 million votes is almost unheard of. And I do not believe that there is enough evidence to suggest that Hillary Clinton stole this primary election. But the bigger problem that the Democratic Party has is that they're not taking the problems that we've seen during the primary seriously. They're doing almost nothing to fix these problems. And if we are looking at a very tight presidential race, which every day the polls are changing, sometimes Hillary's up by double digits, next day the polls show they're neck and neck, so who knows what's really going on? The point is, we can't afford to allow these problems to continue. And Bernie Sanders does know that, and Bernie Sanders is fighting it. They have filed suits about some of the results, not because they think they won or because they're putting up, you know, throwing a hissy fit. It's because they want to make sure that every single vote counts and that everybody who is eligible to vote is able to vote. And that's the difference. That's what some of the Hillary Clinton supporters don't seem to understand about what Bernie Sanders is doing. This has nothing to do with his campaign thinking that they legitimately won. It's about restoring democracy, making sure that everyone who has the right to vote is able to vote. And that's something that the corporate Democrats don't seem to understand. And just like we've seen in elections in years past, it could end up costing them big time in November. Because again, they aren't taking this problem seriously. Bernie Sanders is. His supporters are, sometimes a little bit too vigorously. But Hillary Clinton and the establishment Democrats are not. And all I can say again is that if we're looking at a presidential election that's within 1 or 2 points, that is something the Republicans can steal. They did it in 2000. They did it in 2004. They could easily do it in 2016. The next question is from Twitter user at BaileyAsh06, who asks, is the SCOTUS decision about the Fourth Amendment only for government prosecution? Can we use illegal evidence of government wrongdoing in defense and prosecutions? Now, this question is obviously referring to the recent Supreme Court ruling where they said that illegally obtained evidence, even though that's against the Fourth Amendment, would be allowed in a criminal prosecution. Now, again, the corporate media paid absolutely no attention to the story at all. You are hard-pressed to go and find any coverage of the fact that our Fourth Amendment was basically just dismantled by the U.S. Supreme Court. As for the actual question here that Ashley has asked us, it's very hard to determine what this will and can be used for until it's actually used. Unfortunately, I'm not a lawyer. I haven't been to law school. So I have a very loose, you know, kind of knowledge on all these things. But I do know that a good lawyer can take this into court, or a slimy lawyer, whichever side it's representing there, and they can use this as a precedent to try to get illegally obtained evidence into a lawsuit or a criminal proceeding or what have you. And that's very dangerous because, again, this was written into the Constitution. You know, back in 1776, the founding fathers had the foresight to say, you know what? We need to have a set of rules to where police officers and investigators can't just go snatch all your belongings and present them in a court case. No, they knew back then that if you didn't have a warrant, it shouldn't be allowed. They understood the law. I mean, hell, they wrote it. But for some reason, this Supreme Court, the Republican majority on there, thinks that it's perfectly fine to say Fourth Amendment, eh, you know what? Don't really need it. And the corporate media was all too willing to not pay a single second of attention to this very important issue. And I'm hoping that it doesn't lead to a dangerous precedent. I'm hoping that this case can be overturned in the very near future, because that is a very important standard that we have to have in our legal system. Next up, we have a question from Heathen, who writes, Trump used to be a Democrat and Hillary was a Republican. What does this mean about the validity of political parties? What it means is that we need more than two political parties. It's very easy for someone to just flip-flop between the two. I mean, that is a great point. Although Hillary Clinton has been a Democrat a hell of a lot longer than Donald Trump was a Republican, longer than Donald Trump has been a Republican, excuse me. But, you know, if we had more parties, if we had things that people could switch to as the parties evolve, I think we would be in a much better situation here. And, you know, Donald Trump switching from Democrat to Republican is because the man himself is a flip-flopper. He's going to go with whatever the direction the wind takes him that day, and that is the wind of popular opinion. During the Bush years, it was easier for him to be a Republican than a Democrat. During the Obama years, same thing. He wanted to be on the side that kind of went against the system there. And, you know, didn't work out too well for him, except now he is the nominee, but he's universally hated by his own party. Hillary Clinton, on the other hand, you know, this formerly self-described Goldwater girl, she was born, raised in the South down here. I'm not sure if she was actually born here, but she lived in the South during formative years of her youth. And so it did make a little bit of sense. I'm not trying to defend her flip-flop here, but I also live in the South, and you see it. People call themselves Republicans, think that they stand for these things when they really don't. Having said that, Hillary Clinton is very much a corporatist, middle-of-the-road, Democrat, borderline Republican still. I don't think that her views on the world or this country have changed all that much since she was a Republican to today. I think she still believes the same thing. It's just that the Democratic Party has evolved and shifted enough that those Republican views that she used to hold are now considered mainstream Democratic views. And that is very, very sad to have to say that. Our next question comes from Darren Hickman, who asks, as we succumb to oligarchy, how can we effectively demand change in government and media within the next 4 to 8 years? Well, I think the biggest thing is that it requires participation. The longer people sit out, the worse things become. So when they finally do decide to get up and take action, they have even more work to do because they've allowed things to get so bad. If you want change, you have to be active. Those two are they go hand in hand. You can't want change and do nothing, because then you're no better than the rest of them who say the status quo is fine. If you want things to get better, you have to get out there and get active. It takes work. It takes effort. It takes time. But if you're not willing to commit to those things, then you're not really in favor of change. And as far as the media goes, turn it off. Anyone who turns on the television and watches MSNBC or CNN or Fox News is contributing to the problem. I know, well, oh, I like Rachel Maddow. You can't have it both ways. You have to make sacrifices. If you want change, you have to put in the effort. And most people are not willing to put in the effort. If you want to see change, you have to go lock yourself up to the White House fence with dozens of other protesters. You have to take a stand. I mean, that specific reason right there is why the Keystone XL pipeline was voted down or turned down by President Obama. Because they saw what the people actually wanted, what people were willing to risk in order to prevent this from happening. And it made them rethink their position. The civil rights movement, that's what that was. So it's easy to say we want change or that we need change. And we do. But if you're not willing to go out there and do the work and do the research and turn off that damn TV, then you don't get to complain. Our final question tonight comes from Twitter user Dursa, who asks, SCOTUS cited 8-0 for bribery to dismiss charges against former Virginia governor. Isn't this a betrayal of our left justices? It absolutely is. I have not seen what the justices saw during the case. But for them to unanimously overturn the bribery conviction that another judge, jury, everybody had said, yeah, this guy did it, that's a little absurd. But that's the kind of special political favors you get when you're a high-ranking politician in the United States. And yes, it is a betrayal of the left justices. And not just overturning that conviction. Their failure to overturn convictions that need to be overturned is another failure, and it's probably even bigger than this bribery case. For example, Don Siegelman is still sitting in jail. What was his crime? He took money from a campaign donor, and then later on in the administration, gave that donor a seat on a board. Kind of sounds like the same thing that the government does every single day right now. Now, this was before Citizens United. Oh, so that's a big no-no. But even before Citizens United, that wasn't illegal. There's plenty of evidence to suggest that Karl Rove and the Republican Party specifically politically targeted Don Siegelman because they wanted the governor of Alabama to be a Republican and not a Democrat. That, to me, the fact that Don Siegelman is still sitting in jail is not only a failure of the Supreme Court, but that is the biggest failure of the Obama administration. And that's all the time we have for questions tonight. But if you have a question that you want answered, send it to us on Twitter using the hashtag AskROF. You can follow the show on Twitter at Ring of Fire Radio, and you can follow me at Fair and Balanced.
TheRingOfFire.com. Honest, hard-hitting news, free from corporate influence. Your destination for progressive news, commentary, and interviews. TheRingOfFire.com.
Ben Taxotere, we're hearing a lot about it right now. Permanent baldness for 30 to 40-year-old women that have alternatives where it comes to chemotherapy. But it seems like this company has been pushing their product without warning women that they have an alternative.
Exactly. It's criminal.
Okay. Well, tell me the story a little bit.
So the basic story is this. You've got two drugs, two choices, and one is naturally occurring, produced by Bristol-Myers Squibb. It's called Taxol. So Sanofi, the French company, the ugly company, it's been convicted of all the key TAM violations, paid hundreds of millions of dollars in fine, ugly conduct, said, well, we can do better, and they made a synthetic version. It's poison. It's toxic. It's twice as strong. It's the same molecule, but they made it twice as strong so they could try to beat Bristol-Myers and get that market share. And what they didn't tell people is that because it's twice as strong and it's more toxic, it causes permanent destruction of your hair follicles. They warned only about alopecia, which nobody knows what it means anyway, right, in the lay community, which should mean temporary hair loss. So these women were led to believe, we will cure your cancer and we will temporarily take your hair away. But when your cancer's gone, your hair will come back.
And all
it
they
was
had
a
to
lie.
Do, Ben, here's the point. You know, first of all, you know, women in chemotherapy are trying to save their life. I get that.
Exactly.
But the company played on that, and they understood that there was a much better, more efficacious product out there besides the product that they were trying to compete with Bristol-Myers on. And so they came in with this product. They knew it would cause permanent baldness. So, in other words, medicine A causes permanent baldness for the chemo treatment. Permanent.
Right.
Okay.
Right.
Medicine B does better at treating the cancer and causes no, it causes at best some transient baldness, but the hair grows back and women don't have to live from the time they're 35 years old to the time they die without any hair. Now,
that's
we
right.
may, the, in the male culture, they may say, oh, so what? For a woman to have to go through her life without, you know, with total baldness, with no chance of ever recovering, it's pretty serious stuff, especially when all the company had to do was put a damn warning on the product and say,
that's
look,
right.
you can take medicine A from France that'll make you permanently bald, or you can take medicine B from the United States that will treat the same cancer and
right.
will not make you permanent bald. I mean,
Pap, studies show at least a 1 in 10 chance of permanent baldness in women who take this drug, and they didn't tell them that. So it's a question of human decency. It's a question of informed consent. Tell these women they have a choice. And look, as you said, this is not about men. This is about women. So let's talk to women about it. Women care about their hair. Well, how big is the hair care product industry in this country and in this world? It's billions of dollars. How many of our wives and sisters and daughters and mothers spend hours grooming themselves and getting ready, and how much of that is focused on their hair? It's important, and it's already criminal. And if this company is going to stoop to making these women's victim third time, they've already made them a victim twice. They've said, we'll cure your cancer, and they've given them a good drug, and they've not told them it's toxic, and so then they made them a victim of that. They've got this permanent badge of baldness that they've got to wear for the rest of their lives.
I mean,
see these pictures. They look like Ben Franklin.
The real
what they've done to them.
The real Neanderthals that are going to hear this are going to say, oh, so what? You know, they gave him chemotherapy. They're trying to save their life. Well, no, that's not the analysis. This medicine was not even as good as the medicine that has a better chance at curing cancer, will not make you permanently bald. And for a woman, this is a big issue.
Talk about... Go ahead.
But the point is, I can already hear the defense. Oh, so what? They were trying to, no, this idea they're trying to save their lives and there weren't no alternatives. All you do is give women a chance. Choice is everything.
Tell
choice
them to talk.
Everything
that's
here.
Right. Talk to the scientists. Talk to the oncologists and ask the oncologists whether this is a big deal to the women. Ask the oncologists whether Taxol and Taxotere are the same. What they're going to tell you is that Taxol is more efficacious, is just as powerful, just as good, and or better in treating the cancer and preventing it from coming back as Taxotere without the unwanted risk of permanent baldness, which, by the way, Sanofi still hasn't admitted to fully. The FDA has just now, a month ago, 2 months ago, December, told them you got to modify your warnings, and they still haven't come forward with a really good, clear warning. They've already warned about it in Europe for 10 years. They've warned about it in other countries, but they figured out this market in America is so good, we don't want to take the chance of ruining this market by telling people the truth, telling doctors the truth.
Ben, you're working with a superb firm that has been...
Backus and Shanker, great lawyers.
What's the name of the firm?
Backus and Shanker. Kyle?
Backus and Shanker.
Backus and Darren Shanker, great lawyers.
Yeah, great lawyers. I know of them, and I know their history. But what I love about this story is they've done all of this research and this digging. They've met with thousands of women, and they've tried to figure out, does this case matter? And everybody, without exception, these women, they're permanently bald, say, yeah, this matters. If all they had to do was give me a choice, just give me a
That's
choice.
Right.
Let me make the decision, not some cat in Paris who's already been hit. I think, weren't they hit for like $90 million in a Ketan
That's
case?
Right. $90 million. They've got others pending for paying off doctors, for hiding evidence. I mean, it's an ugly company.
Okay,
and these guys. Let me tell you, these guys. They've done their homework. They have focus grouped this. They have talked to all of these women, and the common denominator for all these women. And shame on those who get on Facebook and say, "Well, you should be lucky, glad that you're alive," because these women have all said, and the studies back this up, that if they had just been told that they had a choice, they could have made an informed decision. That's what this is about. It's about human decency and responsibility and being honest. Tell these women that they could have this risk, and then if they want to take that risk, in spite of that and knowing that, then at least you've done the right thing and you've told them. But this company chose not to put that in their
label. So are you going to be working with Backus and Shanker on this to try to continue? I think the documents are going to be incredible on this case. I think you're going to find documents that are just earth-shattering about what this company knew and what they chose to do simply so they could compete with a company that made a better product.
Well, the fact that that they've known for this for years, that there's studies coming out for at least 10 years or more showing series after series of cases with permanent baldness, and they've chosen not to tell the FDA that, and they've chosen not to put that in their label in America while it's already on the label in France and in Europe, tells you everything. It was good enough for them to tell French citizens about baldness, but they wouldn't tell American citizens because why?
Well, back up. Did they have a warning in France that it would cause?
That's right. They said for the French citizens, we're going to tell you that there's a risk of baldness, but we're not going to tell Americans because it's market share all over again.
Yeah, okay. Ben Gordon, go get them, buddy. Go get them. Pat. Thank you for joining
me,
okay?
To. Yes, sir. Thanks.
Type 2 diabetes is one of the fastest growing epidemics in America, and as a result, big pharma companies are hoping to make it their latest cash cow. But one of the most popular diabetes drugs on the market has been found to have some deadly side effects, and I have attorney David Haynes with me now to discuss those side effects. David, Invokana, a blockbuster diabetes type 2 drug, we're finding out now it has a lot of negative side effects, as often happens with some of these blockbuster drugs. Before we get into those real quick, just kind of give us an overview of what Invokana is specifically used for, as far as the diagnosis and things of that nature.
Well, this is another Johnson & Johnson product, which has become incredibly popular. They've put a lot of money behind it. It is a drug to deal with the control of diabetes, which, of course, is a condition that millions of people have. And diabetes has a lot to do with the acid levels in the particular patient. And this is an inhibitor of some of those issues and has helped to control the diabetes issues. But what we're seeing is, again, with real safety concerns with Johnson & Johnson being raised and real very serious concerns and a lot of very serious adverse side effects for these patients where it appears that Johnson & Johnson has not properly tested this blockbuster drug before bringing it to market and putting millions and millions of dollars behind their advertising instead of more clinical trials prior to pushing it out nationwide.
And what's really interesting is that, Invokana commercials are very common on television, obviously, because, type 2 diabetes is becoming more and more common these days. And so in these commercials, as we've often seen, they show the happy people once they're on the medication, they're living their lives, they're out there having fun, they're barbecuing, they're exercising. And then in the real, professional speak, they start giving all these Invokana may calls, yada, 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 yada. And that's what they do. I mean, there is a difference. The side effects are spoken at a high school grade level. The benefits of the drugs are always spoken at a grade school level. This, study after study has shown that this is the way that these drugs are marketed. And when we're talking about a drug like Invokana, we're looking at something that is causing kidney failure, heart attacks, ketoacidosis. And this is a drug that is meant to, help excrete sugar from the bloodstream through the kidneys. And now, those were just the first side effects we knew of. Now we're starting to see things where people are losing limbs as a result of taking this medication?
Yeah, that's right. I mean, that's the latest FDA advisory that's come out, is that there are a number of cases of amputation. Of course, diabetes patients can be prone to risk for amputation and loss of limb, loss of toes. A lot of times that's where it starts. So if you have a serious diabetes condition, you have to always be cognizant of that, but the information that's coming out is in this recent clinical trial test, which the FDA has issued an advisory about and said that they're going to be checking into further, is that the Invokana drug is greatly increasing the propensity for these types of amputations. So first, this is how the pattern for a lot of these drugs, unfortunately, has played out, is it just information keeps on seeping out about some of the concerns here. First starting with heart attack, stroke, bone fracture, and things like that last year. Those were the advisories that are coming out, and now more recently, the amputation risk. So the issue is that with a lot of these drugs, there are side effects, of course, but the issue is whether the manufacturer, in this case Johnson & Johnson, have properly warned about the potential side effects so that the physician and the patient can make an educated decision about whether or not the drug's pros outweigh the potential cons and the risk, And Johnson & Johnson has not properly warned of these risks, which now are only coming out after the fact. And that is really the disconcerting thing. You know, Johnson & Johnson, we think of it as such a household product in the baby-to-baby shower and talcum powder, which we're learning a lot about cervical cancer there, unfortunately. But it's a household name. But obviously, with the systemic problems at Johnson & Johnson, it certainly appears that advertising and profit is a primary motive here, perhaps over patient safety.
Well, you know, you pointed out something very interesting there, and I want to expand on that just a little bit. And that's the fact that it's not that the drug or any drugs cause side effects. You know, even ibuprofen and Tylenol can cause side effects. A lot of it has to do with the risk-benefit analysis, you know, the side effect of it versus what it does. But the most important thing, and this is where lawsuits come from, is what did the company know? Did they hide it? Did they properly deliver this information to physicians and patients? And it's when there is a cover-up or when they did not disclose that they face liability. It's not just because their product, you know, isn't doing everything it says. It's because they knew it wouldn't and they hid the dangers. And I think that's something that the public needs to understand. People don't just get sued, you know, for no reason. It's because there was a cover-up, because there was no warning.
That's correct. That's correct. And, it, you know, the warnings and we see the fine print and so forth. But and you wonder how much consumers really understand, as you say, with the TV commercials or you look in the, you know, the weekly periodicals and things and you've got all this fine print, which, of course, goes over everyone's head. But a lot of it is education of the physicians as well. Instead, Johnson & Johnson is paying tens of millions of dollars in marketing the products for medical consultants. Literally wining and dining a lot of physicians to the tune of a couple million dollars in food and beverage expenditures for this particular drug. And so they're glossing over a lot of these issues, and either they knew of the problems and they haven't given proper warnings, or they didn't do sufficient medical and clinical trials to determine what the side effects were. And so if a black box warning goes on a particular drug, studies have shown that the prescriptions of that drug may go down by about 40%. And that's what these manufacturers don't want. And so they're making, and oftentimes, unfortunately, they're making calculated decisions about whether it's better to avoid the black box warning and take their chances on the liability side and deal with the lawsuits that come as a result of the various injuries, amputation, stroke, heart attack, or death, versus having their drug, which they're talking about on their quarterly Wall Street conference calls, that this is a great, you know, we're getting great market share in this huge patient population for diabetes. So that is the issue, is the black box warnings, appropriate warnings to the patients. The patients need to, Johnson & Johnson is a very sophisticated company. They need to be putting out all of the information that they have about these drugs so patients can make informed decisions.
As we've seen too many times, it always comes down to profits over patients. And that's why, you know, people like you, the trial lawyers, Mike Papantonio and Howard and Michael Berg, all a part of the show. That's why you guys are out there doing what you do every day to help protect American consumers. And we appreciate your work both in the courtroom and on this show. So, David, thank you very much for talking with us today.
Thank you, Ference. My pleasure.
And that's all the time we have for today, but you can get more news at our website, theringoffire.com. You can get our daily podcast by going online to rofpodcast.com, and you can subscribe to our YouTube channel at youtube.com/goleftv. Follow me on Twitter at Farron Balanced, and you can follow the show at Ring of Fire Radio. I'm Farron Cousins, and thanks for watching.